conscious care and support. Most individuals with developmental disabilities, dementia, and mental health disorders experience emotional suffering that sometimes results in challenging behaviors. In this video, Peter Marks describes how he has integrated evidence-based BFIT mindfulness strategies with brain balancing interventions such as tapping to reduce these risks. He calls his process conscious care and support. Here he demonstrates examples of his training offered to caregivers, supporters, and managers that develops their own emotional self-control and maturity, disengages them from their own fears and insecurities that contribute to aggression in others, de-escalates residents' and patients' difficult feelings and behavior safely and compassionately, and determines the residents' and patients' quality of life. Hundreds of CCS-trained caregivers and managers have actually reduced behavioral incidents with residents and patients by up to 90%, with the corresponding benefits of significantly decreased risks of harm to self, staff, and others, reduction in the use of PRN medications, lowered staffing costs due to fewer stress, sick days off, WSIB claims, overtime, etc., suspension of 911 police crisis calls, because today's trauma often leads to tomorrow's behaviors. And all residents' and patients' quality of life is enhanced due to being able to more fully experience enjoyable social, recreational, educational, and work opportunities. And now, here is Peter teaching mindfulness-based calming and de-escalation strategies as practical and effective ways to do our part.
The ones that I've selected to talk about to you today, these tools, are also very, very helpful. Just bring a level of happiness, contentment, and peace to the people we support, okay? The first procedure I want to talk to you about in terms of helping someone to be just peaceful and happy is something that I'm calling tapping. So what I'm doing now is I'm balancing the left hemisphere and the right hemisphere to have equal electrical potential going through it. And when you do that, solid proof science is that you will stay in a calm state. This actually is developing what we call alpha brain waves. And alpha is the state that you get into when you're feeling really calm and relaxed. And you see, you can learn it in 5 seconds. It's no big deal. But I'm not only balancing Ellie's brain waves. What else am I doing? Because I'm tapping on her with me, I'm balancing my own. So this brings me to an awareness and a calm. And just to do that for, say, 5 or 10 minutes, just make no big deal of it, just start it as standard process. This is just what we do. We brush our teeth, and then we hang around, and you can have participants doing with it with each other. I mean, I've done this in some other settings in around, and I have participants doing it with each other where it's appropriate, where it's possible. So thanks, Ellie. So just, that's called tapping. And it's so simple, it doesn't cost anything, and there's a way that you can double its impact. No surprise, it's with intentionality. When you bring the intention of calming, and we're going to talk about this a bit later on, but when you bring the intention of calming, you're going to significantly enhance the outcomes of that practice, okay? So we call that tapping. Now for some people, and certainly when we talk about people who are experiencing challenging behaviors for whatever reason, to start, and this is what you know we're talking about now in some of the homes where we are supporting people with challenged behaviors, we're actually now, you know, we're talking about the 5 stages of escalated behavior. And at that 1 and 2 level, this is, I would like to see it as mandatory. I mean, when we start to get an indicator that someone's agitation has started, or, you know, drumming, whatever the trigger is, whatever the obvious behavior is, this would be very appropriate. Now, it'll be much more appropriate if you're doing it just as a matter of this is what we do together, right? Because it's natural and normal now. You've normalized it by doing it just when people are feeling normal and okay and whatever. So now you've got it as a really important tool. A tool to, you know, to bring mindfulness to yourself that you're doing it, you're intending to bring calm to yourself and to the other person. I have seen this and I have got responses back from people that are just saying it's unbelievable what it does. Now, if touching isn't a possibility, or even if it is, there's a variation on it, which is, everybody do this for now. It's called the butterfly hug. Just cross your hands like that, and you're doing the same thing. You're now balancing your hemispheres from one side to the other. And to keep that up for 5 or 10 minutes. And in some places, you could just sit down yourself and just start doing this. And you will see, in some of your homes, you will actually see your participants start to do this. And guess what? This is not surprising. We know that many of our participants, and many people who are not, you know, supported by us, have learned that rocking soothes them. You've noticed that with a lot of? Well, this is based on the same neuroscience. The same neuroscience. We're just finding ways to proactively bring in the results of rocking. See what I'm saying? So these are really, really useful tools. And once again, normalize it with the intention. Just sit around, like when you're just sitting around after supper, whenever, just start doing it, okay? Because you're modeling this as normal. And this brings, say, a beautiful calm to people. Mindful walking is something that certainly, you know, you can do. When we talk about the mindfulness practice, some people say, well, you know, like sitting meditations and stuff like this is not for me. I'm more of a tactile, kinesthetic, go get it kind of a person. Well, if that's the case, there's something you can do in terms of mindful walking. And you can also bring this to our participants. And once again, you could just walking normally, and as your foot touches the floor, you are saying to yourself, place, place, place. Peter's aware of being here. Peter's aware of walking. Peter's aware of the soles of his feet. Some great research by a guy named Dr. Singh, I've forgotten his first name. But he's gone into many people who are supporting people with developmental disabilities. He works out of, it's Maryland someplace, where his institute is. And his research, I mean, you have to dial into soles of the feet, mindfulness, and developmental disabilities. Because what he has done is he's gone into homes and agencies where there's been, like, let's say, a use of PRN medications at, let's say 10 level, okay, that, which is their maximum across their 30 or 40 homes. And he literally has brought PRN medication down like 80% just by teaching people to be aware of the soles of their feet. Just soles of the feet. Peter's aware that he's got a sensation in the soles of his feet right now. Of course, I've been doing so much that I just naturally do this, but you can do this too. And when you walk, and you get up from the table, you walk over here, you just become aware of where you are and the soles of the feet. And that's what we call noticing. And noticing is a real, like many of you have training maybe in grounding strategies. Well, noticing is a real grounding strategy, and this is a great way to notice in a tactile way. You can also notice visually, audio, whatever, but you know, you've likely been trained in those, but noticing through kinesthetic, through physical touch is a really, really powerful way to reach the people who we're supporting. Progressive muscle relaxation is a strategy that, once again, you can teach our participants, certainly teach yourself to calm yourself, because as I said in the first half, this is tough, tough work. And we know who you're trying to support and kind of some of the challenges you have. So for all of these, just to do them for yourself, just when things start to get rough, right? I mean, there. But progressive muscle relaxation, there's many ways to do it. If you're a little bit more cognitively able, then you can take people through, like, okay, scrunch up your shoulders and let them go. Tighten your shoulders and let it go. Tighten your fist, let it go. Tighten your fist and let it go. And this, once again, is a great mindfulness strategy, but it's also a great grounding strategy. Because the more you can bring, you see, what you're doing in all of these is you're bringing the chattering mind that's busy on its own, locked into those thoughts, causing the nervous system to get anxious and upset and all that. What you're doing is you're kind of taking it off that and deploying it skillfully other places. And this is maybe one of the most miraculous gifts from the creative source, and that is this, that we only have a finite amount of conscious energy. This is why all this stuff works. You see, every one of you have been going down that highway 3 years, and one day you notice the three-story building you hadn't seen before, right? I mean, everyone has that experience, right? Yeah. Every one of you, as I've asked in my classes, you've cut yourself and not noticed it until you're in the shower that night. Missed it. Missed the pain. How could that be? It's because your mind was engaged someplace else. But that's not the whole of it. The whole of it is that mind's only got a limited capacity. We can actually only, the average person can only handle 7 7 units of awareness at once. So you can, you know, you can remember a phone number, but you can actually only see, like right now, all of you simultaneously, the best you're taking in is me, the screen, the floor, the walls, whatever. 7, and then you're maxed out. The nervous system cannot look at 10, 20, 30 things simultaneously. It can't. It can only do 7 things. So if you tie it up with soles of the feet awareness, you tie it up with muscle relaxation, you tie it up with this, you're not only working with the neurology in terms of the brain kind of just going to being balanced, but you're tying up some of the conscious energy that would normally be going into making anxiety, anger, agitation happen. Understand that? See, agitation, anger, and all of those difficult areas, what they are giving us is this feedback from the system to survive. And if you tie up that energy, then it cannot make anxiety, anger, whatever, aggression. So it comes at 2 levels. It's the balancing energy system, but it's also using the mindfulness door. It's tying up energy that now is not, like you can't build on the real estate because you've already used up all the real estate, which is the conscious mind. Understand that? That's it's a really important understanding as to why we're talking this way. Mindful breathing, of course, which most of you have done in my classes for sure, and which is pretty standard in our sector, actually, even if you're not into a mindfulness, there's kind of be aware of breathing in and breathing out. But by the way, if you've been trained in breathing or calming breathing, excellent. But it's important that when you encourage someone to do mindful breathing, that you give them a full instruction on how to do it. And indeed that you do it yourself. It's not just, oh, breathe in and out. Just breathe in and out, and you're gonna get, well, it's not gonna do it. Where is your mind when you're breathing in and out? If your mind is breathing in and out is still thinking about hitting someone or still thinking about, you know, kind of the, you know, feeling hurt or whatever, then the breathing in and out is minimally useful. Just bring the extra bit of awareness to it. John, pay attention to breathing in. And you see, you're bringing people into mindfulness, and this calms, because you're tying up the real estate that would normally build into agitation, anger, and aggression. Okay? It takes like you're learning it right now. There's nothing more to learn. There's no mystical tricks to this. It's really not. It's just doing the stuff that you learn in 10 seconds, right? And of course, you have a great music program here and drumming. Drumming, of course, also has its own. You see, when you drum with 2 hands, it's much better than drumming with 1. You see why? Why? Because you're balancing both sides of the brain again. Exactly. Exactly. So your music programs, your drumming programs, I mean, Denise is likely going to hit me here because I'm going to talk about increasing budget, but every home should have some drums in it. Okay? What can I say? She's a bit conservationist par excellence. Okay. And of course, you're familiar with, you know, favorite activities and pictures and the calming and consciousness that we're going to talk about in a second. Describing feelings, you know, just putting that out. These are kind of 10 basics to increase calm and whatnot. Because mindfulness is basically, it's the 3 things, right? It's in your notes, but basically, it's paying attention to what you're doing when you're doing it. Peter's aware that he's been talking for a bit. It's doing an activity that I know I'm doing. So I'm not only paying attention to what I'm doing, but I'm also knowing that I am doing it. So right now, everybody become aware that you're listening to me. That's high-end mindfulness. The thing is, you just have to hold on to it for a while. So what you're doing, you pay attention to, and that you're doing it, you pay attention to. And then finally, we pay attention to what your body sensations and your thinking and your feelings are doing as a result of what you're doing physically. So I'm out here, I'm eating an apple, I'm aware of eating the apple, and that gives me certain sensations in my mouth, texture, gives me certain flavors, gives me certain, you know, other body sensations. That's all mindfulness is. It's being aware of what I'm doing. By the way, a good way to look at that is the difference between how you drive your car normally and how you drive your car when there's a police car behind you. That's the difference. That is forced mindfulness, okay? It's forced, and that's what it is. I mean, believe me, you are fully aware of what you are doing, right? You know, just like you were when you had beginner's mind, when you first started to drive, right? Hands are in the wheel, you know, you're just, you know, taking your lessons and, oh, no, I'll never do this, and my speedometer, I got too much to think about. Now you kind of, you know, you sit back and you're doing 120 with a burrito in your hand and one hand listening to tunes in your iPod, right? I mean, that's the mindless mind, because that's what it's designed to do. Learn, learn, adapt, and put it in the back, and what's next? Bigger, better, more, bigger, better, more. It's only when you become mindful that you get back to beginner's mind, which is where all the joy in life can come from, for no good reason, right? For no good reason. When you are mindful, very, very little what we call intellectual or cognitive is happening, and you truly learn to value that place, which is the place where a lot of our participants live. So it stops becoming an intellectual exercise of, oh, I should be loving, I should be kind. You know, like, you know, this is sad. That is not what people we support need. What they need is a genuine, authentic connecting. And you get that by living in that space. And the more you do mindfulness practice, any of the great seven traditions hold an abundance of wisdom on how to get here. But all of those practices bring you to basically non-cognitive functioning. The more time you spend there, the more beautiful it is, the more you see the happiness from no reason there. It just, there's a cascade of things that come out of your observer self just observing you in that space. Does that make sense? So that's a little bit more on, you know, kind of where I had to go on the mindfulness piece. But when you consider the little amount of investment it takes to just so exponentially improve the quality of care and support that we can offer, it's one of life's better deals for sure. We have a tradition in our culture that at memorials and celebrations of life, often inspirational songs are played and music is played that kind of would remind, you know, one of the celebration of this life, right? So how many kind of think about that? Think about, I wonder what, you know, song would be going for me if I was to have a memorial. Anybody think about that for themselves? Yes? Yeah, yeah. Most of them do. Okay. So my granddaughter, Olivia, several years ago, we were at her first funeral, and she came out, and the first question she had was, she says, Papa, do you have a song? And I said, I really don't. She says, well, what do you think it would be if you were to pick a song? And I said, I don't know, I'll let you know. So a few weeks later, I picked a song, but I said, I'm not ready to die yet on this one, because I'm not here, okay? This is a song I gotta grow into, all right? So my life is not here. But if I was to be able to say this is a song I want to grow into that might celebrate my life, it would go something like this. And this talks about a family. The family I kind of think of here is CUNY Living Cambridge, of course. Anyway. How do we start to do our part?
Do you know what it takes? It takes a real, real sacred warrior who will enjoy and experience the power of what Stephen Covey, just died this year, great, great contributor here, called private victories. It's the private victories that take us from good to great. It's what nobody knows about what you're doing. It's you getting up that extra half or early and doing your physical workout, eating properly, doing your mindfulness practices, reading that little book for 10 minutes. No one knows about this stuff. No one knows That is where the difference is made in the people who really can have a life that's got incredible potential for themselves, and where they've also then got the capacity and the skills, frankly, to enhance the life of other people. When they look back at me.